This is Tweet Street Satirical Soul Tire, broadcasting to you from unoccupied Scotland. Amplifying women's voices and saying women won't waste. This is Tweet Street Satirical Soul Tire, broadcasting to you from unoccupied Scotland. Amplifying women's voices and saying women won't waste.
Welcome along to Occupied Scotland, everyone. I'm Simon Bridges, aka Peter. With me today, as usual, is my co-host JB Whitesnake. All right, John, how you doing, mate?
Not bad, Peter. Good to see you in a Sunday bar.
And you, buddy, and you, mate. We're here for one reason and one reason only. We've got an interview with a guest who I think is fascinating. Mother, filmmaker, wife to a jailed ex-diplomat. We've got Nadira Murray with us today. Hi, Nadira, how are you?
I'm fine, thanks. Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome. We're so happy that we could manage to get a suitable time for you to come along, so that we could, because we didn't want to interrupt. You know, obviously, you've got your young family that you're looking after, and you're trying to do everything on your own at the minute. So we're just going to fire away with some questions, if that's okay with you, and just answer them as you feel free to, Nadira. So first of all, if you could tell us, our viewers, subscribers, a bit about your life before meeting Craig, your thoughts on law and justice as you became more socially aware back home, Nadira.
Well, before meeting Craig, my life, well, it's a big question, isn't it? It's a long question with loads of bumpy rides. I can briefly tell you. I'm from Uzbekistan. I grew up during Soviet times until age 10. And after Soviet Union collapsed, the next stage was I grew up in a country was full of corruption, poverty struggle, identity crisis, and dictatorship and fear. So I came from a family of actors. My dad was a playwright, actor. My mom was an actress at the State Theater. So I grew up watching my dad's play being banned by the state. And so he was actually a very clever writer, and he would use a lot of metaphors and symbols and in his writing. But he was also under a government's watch list because his writing applied or ignited some freedom and slavery, unjust unfairness. You know, I even witnessed one day my dad, I was very young, was taken away to the police station for voting opposition. That's the country. I'm just kind of painting out how I grew up and the fear of it. And, you know, at some point, you know, we even had to hide his writings as well as a child. So I wasn't just a child. I was an adult child. So I had to grow up very quickly, and we were very careful. I mean, whole people, nation was very careful and obedient, very fearful, careful of what to say, not to say anything or criticize or not to ask any questions, even at school, especially, you know, about our government or police. So we had no human rights at that time. Whoever was against government or criticized would just disappear. So again, obedience, keeping silence, praising the government, you know, praising, pleasing the authority, you know, with your work, and fear, corruption, unjust. Growing up in the circumstances will, you know, slowly turns you into some kind of slave, you know. So that's that angle, you know, before I met Craig, apart from other angles. So this was, before I met Craig.
It's in a way, it's fascinating for the point of view that it seems so far away from my life growing up and probably John's life growing up as well. You know, it seems so the opposite end of the spectrum. John, over to you, mate. You got a question you want to ask Nadira?
Yeah, certainly. When you first met Craig and you obviously fell in love, what qualities helped you fall for Craig? And what type of person did you see him as at the time?
So there's another angle. <I've got so many. laughs> I'm a filmmaker, so I kind of try to which angle. So he said, you know, at the start of our relationship, he said one day, at the very start of a relationship, I said, can I take you somewhere? Would you translate something from Uzbek into English? And then I said, okay. So he took me, and he took me in the middle of nowhere, like village, out of capital. And I was even surprised how he knew that location, that small village. And when we reached there, we saw a very old woman who was beaten and bruised. And I learned that she was beaten by police, by the state, that her sons were taken away and put into a prison for a terrorism act, and they written down confession, you know, false confession in front of her. And that's why she was beaten up, and so that sons could write confession. So and her apple trees were completely chopped off, and her land was taken away. So she was seeking help from a British ambassador. I didn't mention that Craig was British ambassador in Uzbekistan between 2002-2004. So at that time when I met him, so I did translate from a old lady from Uzbek into English, and I had tears at some point. And sorry, let me drink this water. Sorry, I'm okay. It's just and so there were, you know, many such cases. Craig himself would visit such people, politically abused and tortured. So we also went together to this shelter, women's shelter, where abused women who put kerosene and they burn themselves. That's kind of a cultural thing in my country. So they want, the aim is to die, but some of them would not die from, so they would be injured. So there was just this house shelter. And when we went to visit these women, he donated from his own pocket money to this, you know, group of, to this shelter, those abused women. So I'm, you know, for me, of course, there is the angle of being he was old and he had just belly, you know, popping out. So, and I was young, and that is that angle. But you know, when you see him doing this kind of things, and you start to understand who he is, you know, he's a human, he's humanly, you know, and he was championing human rights in Uzbekistan. It's just two things I mentioned. There are many, many more. And you can find in his book, Murder in Samarkand, his memoir book, he wrote all about his time in Uzbekistan. So he was too caring, and he would get easily emotional seeing such abuse, and he would also get very passionate and angry and be persistent on, you know, trying to sort out through government ministry, justice ministry in Uzbekistan to take action against these injustices. So, yeah, he was a man in his kilt, in the middle of nowhere, in mountains in Uzbekistan, caring about women's issues and human rights and apple trees. And that's sweet. Yeah, that was kind of cute in my eyes. So he was humble, you know, and everybody, ordinary people, came to really fond of Craig in Uzbek people, and thanked him for being listened, you know. They used to call him William Morris because he used to go with his Scottish flag in his ambassadorial car. He had a Scottish flag and he would be with his kilt. So he was but very with English accent. It's like, I remember I used to have a Braveheart ringtone on my phone to surprise him. So yeah, well, he helped to powerless. He gave voice to people who didn't have voice, and in my country. So yeah, it's in great detail in his book.
We'll move on and bring it up to, because we're limited to what we can say. Want to get into any legal issues. So if we bring it forward, Nadira, because I've been speaking on many occasions, and it saddens me to hear the impact that this full situation has had on your kids, and especially your 12-year-old. Could you elaborate on this a little bit for us, please, without it being too intrusive to your family, but just the impact that this full situation is having on you?
Yeah, you know, my 12-year-old, he's a pre-teenage, and he just started high school. He was hit very badly emotionally, and he was very angry. Angry because nobody could explain to him properly, neither he couldn't understand what exactly his dad was charged in order to sit in high security prison.
Yeah.
Because you know, this is just outrageous. Of course, by now, you know, he understood that it is deliberate act to put him in jail, to shut him up, maybe, or break the spirit of any writers or speak, you know, truth tellers. So he now knows. But he's angry and frustrated and disappointed with the government. And, you know, he was, first question was, he was asking, but mom, he's not criminal. He's not criminal. Why they put him, so there's so many whys, why they put him in jail? Why no one is helping us? Who could we tell to help us? Why no one is, you know, like loads of whys, you know, I can understand. And he was asking, what about his medicine? You know, he's not very, you know, he's poorly, Craig is, he's not 100% healthy person. He was always under my watch, his medication and all. So, but luckily that his medication is with him. My son's first question was, will he be allowed his medication? Yes, he is. But he hasn't seen any hard doctors yet, for example, up until now. And he's been locked in a high security prison and he's allowed only once a day. Okay, it's COVID. They're saying it's a COVID rules, but I think, is it necessary to jail up an old man who's not even healthy? He's poorly to do such. What do you gain out of it? I just don't understand. But anyway, I can get emotional as well. So yeah, he's fine. But you see, another thing is, he could only see, up until now, he could only see his dad only twice since October. He's been jailed August 1. So he's seen that his dad twice, you know. That's because they weren't family visits, and I had to chase them. And finally, when I asked the family officer in prison, I said, well, it's my child's right to see his dad, and you are denying. And it just worked. And within 10 minutes, they said, okay, come back in 2 weeks time. So last week on Saturday, he saw once. And the next visit, we have to wait, who knows? We can't now hold off any officers to ask, can we come again? So you need to chase them. I really don't know what goes on. I understand prison and prisoners are forgotten people, you know? And like, but what if someone like Craig, and I mean, he shouldn't be at criminal prison. He's a civil prisoner, but he's mingled inside and he's just seeing the consequences of all other criminal prisoners. You know, he's not having privileges of civil prisoner.
Yeah.
It must
be a hard position to be in, Nadira. John, over to you. What's the next question?
Yeah. It appears to me today you're actually a natural when it comes to public speaking. How are you coping as a wife, a mother, and a filmmaker, all rolled into one?
I'm all right. I am surrounded by really great friends and my family. My brother is here, my best friend is here, and they're helping me around with my baby. And my filmmaking career is going really good. I'm in post-production, and I just love creative side of making films. So I buried myself into creativity. I'm writing another three projects and developing projects. So although I'm a little bit blocked currently, but I know it will come back. So I'm really good. But the other day when I was giving a speech, I was the guy interference. I don't know, you were very kind to help me. you were taking video, I think, and that threw me a bit, and it shook my emotions, because I suddenly had the same kind of flashback as in my country, and this deliberate attempt of causing trouble in a way to involve you so that you then get involved and the police can arrest you, because in Uzbekistan we used to have a lot of this kind of deliberate attempt. And then
before you go any further, I've got a clip here. I'm going to play that clip. Is that okay? Because I was videoing, I was there watching and videoing the heckler approached. So I'll play that, and if you give me your thoughts, just as you were doing there, once we've seen the clip, okay?
Okay, yes.
Thank you. You remember, if you have a second, John, get it this time.
Go for two.
We are all here today because we are worried for Scotland's future. My husband Craig would be standing alongside all of us here today had he not been locked in a cell for 52 hours a day. Away from his family and from his life. The Scottish Government has made a show of putting the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child into Scottish law. Article 10 says, the impact on children must be considered in all decisions that affect them. Article 12 states, the child's voice must be heard. My oldest son does not feel like his voice is being heard. He has not been able to see his father in prison since he started his school, high school, in mid-August. Every time I visit prison,
This is a breach of the peace.
You break me up. Did you hear that? Hear what he said to me? He's going to break me up.
I will just stop just as you were explaining, the chat approached, you were explaining that that's something, there was agitators back in Uzbekistan that used to come and cause trouble and agitate in the crowds.
This is why I got little bit, you know, it's a flashback, you know, it happens in your brain almost like, it took me a while that I was in Uzbekistan. You know, don't forget that I'm having still postpartum hormones. And for me, it's like exaggerated. And I felt fear. And I was like, only by the sound of people in the crowd that carry on, Nadira, carry on. And they were so, and then you guys took, you know, you guys were, you know, trying to calm me down and come. And then the sound, only sound, carry on, Nadira, you know, that kindness of people and support, and that brought me in. And then I kind of gathered myself and my emotions and I said, no, I'm in Scotland, I'm not in Uzbekistan, you know, just kind of things in your brain. Yeah. It just is a very, you know, quick, it is really quick.
Well, it must have been slightly for you. It took me longer than it probably should have for a reaction. I was kind of in disbelief at first, and I thought, "Wait."
Yeah.
And when he stopped, and he didn't bypass, he didn't say which way is this, and I thought it was maybe just somebody drunk. But at that point, I thought, "Well, I'm not allowing that." I came and stood directly in front of you, and I thought, "I'm not allowing this man to get anywhere near you because it must have been scary." And given the climate, everything that's happening, especially with the Sarah Everard case and women's rights in Scotland, it must have been a scary place for you to be for continuing.
Thank you. But I mean, you guys were very, and the crowd was very supportive. But then it's not the first thing I'm experiencing. It's just I didn't expect it from Scotland. So... but that was, I mean, you heard him saying beat me up, all of a sudden he said that.
Yeah.
This is such a, you know, I have a vivid memory from back in my country, like, and they would deliberately, it's like, you said you would beat me up, like you said that, you know. Oh, you said something against police, even though you didn't, you know, this is just a deliberate attempt so that you could get involved in his mess. And then, the mess so,
thankfully, there was a lot of decent people there, very strong adult human females and males were there on that day. John, over to you for the next question, mate.
Yeah, certainly. I've noticed that the NUG, amongst others, have reacted to the first world jailing of your husband and the father of your children, Craig. How have you received the news?
Well, it's very important that NUJ support Craig. They should. I don't know what to say. It's heartbreaking for me. You know, I would just say I didn't expect this, you know, here in Scotland. It's just everything. I mean, Scottish Court even, you know, they dismissed Craig's poor health, even though he provided a letter from social works report and doctor's report that his well-being would be at risk if forced to be in jail. I think they should really support Craig because it's an attack on writers. It's an attack truth tellers, free thinkers. It's breaking a spirit of whoever is writing and questioning establishment, stopping bloggers or writers to have freedom of speech, stopping them to write is a start of totalitarianism, you know, is a start of this kind of system, which I came from. It's just, who would benefit locking him up? I think they should be very, I think they should help. It's important if they support.
Well, I mean, I'm thankful seeing the increased mentions of Craig's name in places of influence, like the NUAJ, etc. These places should be taking Craig's case very seriously. It's a very sad indictment in Scotland in 2021 that Craig is in jail for what he's in jail for. It's politically motivated, as if you ask me. Finally, I just wanted to ask, is there any messages you wish to get out there and that we can expect to hear from you in the short to mid-term? And also just to ask, do you support Scotland's right to be an independent nation among nations?
I do. I think Scotland should be independent. It's I love Scotland. It's different. I intellectually I hatched from here, so I consider myself Scottish. It's given me a freedom. It's given me a voice as a woman. You know. It's different, different vibe Scotland has. My message would be, freedom of speech and equality before the law is extremely important. And so we should keep searching for answers and keep asking questions. We shouldn't settle down if something feels not right. We should keep, pestering for answers. And we shouldn't forget that politicians work for us, and we elect them, we vote for them, and they work for our best interest. So and we should demand our rights, and our children should see this in us. And they should see us being active and protesting, being loud on our rights, on our civil rights. We shouldn't normalize things by being silent, banning things. We shouldn't get, into normalizing this. This is not good. That's it.
Well, I would like to say thank you. From myself and for Tweet Street. John, over to you, mate.
Yeah, I'd like to commend Nadira. Her use of English language is far better than mine, even though it's her second language. So all credit to Nadira, who's been excellent, and I wish her well, and Craig and her family all the very best in the future. And hopefully we'll be reunited very, very soon, because it's only justice that it is that happens.
2 months left, hopefully.
Good, 2 months left. And I know it's Craig's birthday coming up on the 17th of the month. So I'm going to say happy birthday to Craig on the 17th of the month. John?
Yeah, very happy birthday. I want to see you out and about, back with your family, and hopefully campaigning for an independent Scotland when you're up to it.
Okay, cool. See you around, guys.
Right, thanks, Nadira. Thank you so much for taking the time out today. And
Now, the breakup of Britain is happening, whether we like it or not. The raison d'etre for the United Kingdom was an imperial project. You needed to have that critical mass in landmass, resources, people power to run the empire, to win the empire. The empire physically now has gone. And Brexit, if you want, I'm sure it's been described on your show before, as a kind of a post-imperial tantrum, this country. And that has, but not by design, but the outcome of that is Scotland voting to stay inside the European Union has seen, I think, the breakup of Britain kind of been put on rocket boosters.
The head of Vote No Borders was a gentleman called Malcolm Offord, who is also the director of Akanchi. And Mr. Offord is a contributor to the Conservative Party, who had donated £120,000 and had, in addition, donated money to the personal election expenses of Michael Gove. And Mr. Offord was talking about Vote No Borders and saying it was a grassroots movement of ordinary Scottish citizens who had risen up to defend the union.
Non-political, not affiliated to Better Together, a grassroots people campaign to allow voices to be heard from ordinary people who want to put their hand up and say, do you know what? I don't want to leave the union. It works for me. In fact, I quite like it. It's like a cup of hot chocolate and I want to keep it.
It was shown on the BBC 24 news channel every 30 minutes over a 24-hour period. It wasn't just on the BBC dedicated news channel. It was on every single BBC news bulletin. So here you have a PR company, which is paid by governments and is in receipt of money from the UK government, which is producing this so-called campaigning organisation.
Non-political.
Which did not, in fact, exist. It actually had no members and no branches. Now it doesn't make me feel that I ought to be low again. Anyone who takes offense at a day in your celebration. Cause we all know in our mind that there ought to be a sign that we can set aside to show just how much we love you. And I'm sure you would agree, what could fit more perfectly than to have a world party on the day you came to be. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. I just never understood how a man who died for good could not have a day that was, he said, a sight for his recognition. Because it should never be just because some cannot see the dream as clear as he.
This is Tweet Street Satirical Soul Tire, broadcasting to you via an occupied Scotland, amplifying women's voices and saying women won't waste. This is Tweet Street Satirical Soul Tire, broadcasting to you via an occupied Scotland, amplifying women's voices and saying women won't waste.